back in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, there was a guy by the name of Andy Warhol. Andy Warhol, who was deemed a genius when he painted a suitcase. A suitcase! He's like,
what do you think?
It's a soup can.
Yes. But it's Campbell's. Tomato! What do you think now? Whoa! That's good, just good. No, that's good.
This day and age we're living in gives cause for apprehension. With speed and new invention and things like third dimension. Yet we get a trifle weary with Mr. Einstein's theory. So we must get down to earth at times, relax. Relieve the tension, no matter what the progress, or what may yet be proved. The simple facts of life are such, they cannot be removed. You must remember this, a kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh, just a sigh, just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. As time goes by.
Randy was born in 1928. In the locality that we lived in, it was kind of a poor neighborhood, you know, 2 miles from the city of Pittsburgh. The number of the place was 3252 Dawson Street, and that's where Andy went to elementary school. Brought him into kindergarten, and I left him there. Right after school, there was no Andy. I got home and I says, what happened? He says, some little girl hit me. He feared on going to school. So my neighbor picked Andy up and Andy was screaming and everything. He took him, he says, I'll put him in school. That day, when he got back, he was already getting like called to sing Vita's dance.
I don't know why they call it a dance, because he couldn't, you know, stand still, like, you know, he'd touch stuff, he'd have to touch something. And when he would talk, you could just tell by the voice it wasn't like normal.
Mother wouldn't let him go for a year. During that year, he also contracted scarlet fever. So he had to lay around in bed for months. He was the youngest, and of course, him being so sensitive, and we always thought that maybe he would contact some kind of an ailment, so we watched him.
When he was sick, you know, laying in bed, and he had the book that my mother bought that he would, you know, color in it, you know, he would cut the pictures out and paste it on there. Then he used to write to movie stars.
He used to get movie stars. And one day he says to me, maybe you can get me some of the movie stars to autograph the pictures. And I says, sure, all right.
His brothers wouldn't let him come to New York by himself. They thought he was too young. They would let him go to New York only if we would live together. But I thought it was good to get Andy out of Pittsburgh, where there was no future, really.
When I said that I was leaving, he said, well, I'm leaving too. I said, no, stay, meet some people, have some fun. He came down, as we were going down the stairs, there were people arriving for the party, coming up the stairs. When we got down on the street, it was raining slightly, but I knew a taxi would come along soon and bring some more guests. We stood under an awning of a taxidermy shop, which is unusual for me. There was a head of a deer there with antlers and some small animals, and in the corner, a stuffed peacock on a pedestal. And I told him that when I was a child, I grew up on a farm, and that my father had a flock of peacocks. They would rest up in the trees at night, and we loved the peacocks. Anyway, a cab came. Anyway, I went to the show the next day, took care of that, went to work on Monday. When I came home Monday night, the elevator man had my mail and said, here's your mail, and a package came for you upstairs, and it was the peacock. And Andy and I became best friends for many, many years.
Our first meeting was, he was showing me all his rejections. He had to, you know, sob over a frozen hot chocolate because Diana Vreeland didn't like any of his drawings and didn't accept them. So I said, Andy, I have an idea. And he said, what's that? I said, I'll take all of them on memo and frame them for you and let's see if we can sell them. So we put our heads together and we framed them very simply, and we charged $25 each. In about 2 weeks, we were sold out, because at that particular time, we had fabulous people coming in from Hollywood, from all the Vogue editors, and so they snapped everything up very quickly, because he was famous for all his watercolors. At that time, he used India ink exclusively. Well, I think he used people's enthusiasm to boost his
own. Keep him going,
energy,
get excited.
Exchange, yes, exactly.
Oh, wow, that is absolutely amazing. So now, do you happen to have any of the pieces you guys worked on?
He was very sweet and very kind. He gave me about 32 drawings of myself.
He's Wireland.
Yeah, just gave them to me. He sat down one day and said, I want to do some drawings of you. And I said, okay. So he said, put your leg on the table, put your elbow on the table, and he just
really
just took a pen and sketched, and I have them.
But awesome.
You know, the
Man.
Amazing thing is he was a fabulous draftsman, and he didn't make a mistake. He didn't do one correction.
Salary from the beginning, you know, so there's no misunderstanding.
Oh, Drella never pays the actors.
You expect them to work for free?
I'm the bad to sing along with me, but she won't sing this song if she needs orderly. We still pity the men I know. So you're a tough guy, like you really rough guy, just can't get enough guy, just always so puff guy. I'm that bad type, make your mama sad type, make your girlfriend mad type, might seduce your dad type. I'm the bad guy. Duh.
Excuse me, Mr. Warhol, can we have a minute?
Now's not a good time. This is a BM.
Just a few questions.
No questions, no answers, just BM.
We have an urgent matter we'd like to discuss with you regarding one of your party guests.
Why don't you come back next week after the happening has happened?
I'm sorry, Mr. Warhol, you like talking real slow.
We got important stuff to do,
and I got a planet to save.
You're distressing. Everything about you upsets me.
God damn it, Kay! Were you trying to blow my cover?
Agent W, your cover is safe. Whoa, Andy Warhol is one of us?
An art professor I know, who happened to live very near Andy, had invited me to dinner with a bunch of people. I arrived, and we're sitting there and chatting, and she said, I'm going to put you beside Andy Warhol. It's really terrible, because I was intimidated by him. He was very famous. But also what he was famous for was that he was so cool. I thought, I'm this nobody who's going to sit by this famous guy, and he's going to be all the stuff that's made him famous, and I'm going to be all the stuff that's made me not. And it's going to be pretty grim, right? And also he had a reputation for being totally silent. So I would say hi, and he wouldn't say hi back, or something like that. So we sat down, and he said something, and I said something. And he said something back. And about 45 minutes later, I looked up, and it was like I'd been in a trance. Everyone had left the table. We were locked in this conversation. It was completely hypnotizing. He'd given me his complete attention, and I had given him my complete attention, so much so I didn't even notice what other people were doing. He was the almost magnetic power.
Well, if you ever saw Andy draw, he was really great at that, or put colors together. He was really great at that. He had a talent for making things happen. If Andy wasn't around, nothing would get done. It's just chaos. But if Andy was there, with all this going around, these amazing things would come out of it. I've never seen anything like it. It was amazing. You know, you'd really want Andy to be there, because if Andy wasn't there, nothing would happen. It would just go in circles, on and on and on, people fighting and this, and never get done. And Andy would show up, and he's, you know. And all of a sudden, it was like really clear and relatively easy to do.
So there's pop popping in out of cubism and collage, but it's because it's a master artist who sees this and understands it. It's the design that went into that in the manufacturing process is so exquisite, and it's just a pack of cigarettes. But if you really look at it, it's a master crafted art piece. In the 60s, the whole world became exposed like that. And that was the gist of what pop was in America here, that everything became art.
Well, for instance, like filming the Empire State Building. This is like years ahead of its time, because he had thought of it as like a moving picture that would be on your wall. You know, you look at your wall, it's always moving.
Uh-huh.
And you would see one of the great sights in New York, the sun coming up over the Empire State Building.
Yeah.
Now, here we are 20 odd years later, and they've got environmental cassettes for VCRs. And what do they have on them? The woods for 2 hours. or a stream. No one's done the Empire State Building, of course, but his idea was even better. It would go for 24 hours. You would always have that great view. It's incredible. What a great idea. But of course, people laughed at him because he showed it in a theater. But with a lot of Andy's stuff, the idea was almost as good as the actual thing. No one knew who the Velvet Underground was, and nobody cared either.
The advantage of having Andy Warhol as a producer was that because he was Andy Warhol, they left everything in its pure state. And they would say, "Is that okay, Mr. Warhol?" And he'd say, "Oh, yeah." And so they didn't change anything. And so right at the very beginning, we experienced what it was like to be in the studio and record things our way and have essentially total freedom. The record company never listened to the records in the first place, so they came out exactly like they'd been made. And we got to experience that freedom, but the only real reason I think we had that freedom is because Andy, as the quote producer, was saying, "Oh, that's great." And they say, "Oh, well, should we do this and that too?" He said, "Oh, no, you should. It's really great."
So he was a catalyst.
He was a protector.
Is I'll Be Your Mirror a song about that whole business of Warholism, if you like, of reflecting back to people what they want to see?
It's about reflecting back more than just what they want to see. It's sometimes reflecting back to them what they should see and don't know.
Here she comes. You better watch your step. She's gone to break your heart in two. Everybody knows the thing she does to please.
Тепер заспівам по лісом зелененьким брала вдова лендрівненьки. Ой, по лісом зелененьким брала вдова лендрівненьки. Брала, вибирала, і так собі заспівала. Брала, вибирала, і так собі заспівала.
Somebody always told me, "Oh, you got to start writing your own stories." And I wanted to write a story about my dad and my Uncle Andy, how different they were. Paul being the gregarious, extroverted type of guy, big and burly. And then my uncle being this fine artist, very delicate, unique individual living in New York. I mean, they were so vastly different. That's when I asked my father about if he ever called ahead for when we went to visit. And of course, he said it would ruin the surprise. And there I got the inspiration to do a book about these trips. And the particular trip that I came up with was in 62 when my uncle started doing his pop art. And that was, he was experimenting with product paintings. And of course, it's the Campbell's soup can that became his, you know, like big image that kind of got him recognized in 1962. So he was working on a whole bunch of different pop art paintings that year. I mean, he was doing S&H Green stamps, Fragile, you know, labels. He was doing dollar bills, Coke bottles. 2 years after he went to New York, his mother showed up. So she decided to move in with Andy because both boys back in Pittsburgh were married and they had their own families, and she felt left out. So she went to New York to stay with Andy and take care of him. And so it was my grandmother and my Uncle Andy that we would visit. That's how I knew my uncle, you know, from the very beginning, was him living in New York City as an illustrator, living with my grandmother. My uncle was really good at delegating work. As kids, we were rambunctious and noisy, and he put us to work. So first it was just moving boxes. Oh, can you take all this stuff out and take it up to the third floor? And he knew that we were good workers. We worked in my dad's junkyard. We were good with our hands. So he decided to show us how to stretch canvases.
It's only when he was doing really large paintings he needed to get a bigger space outside the house. So at that point, he got this place called The Factory. He called it The Factory. And that's when, that's the stories you hear about his, all the people that used to visit him and the people that he had working for him, the eccentrics, the actors, all the strange stories. That was at The Factory. But his home life was pretty ordinary. You know, he'd come home, he wouldn't bring any of that home. In fact, he kind of kept his home life separate from his professional life. He was very talkative with us. He wasn't shy, but that's family. You know, he'd always ask us what we were up to, and he'd always take an interest in what we were doing. But he also was, if we were up to some mischief of some sort, he would yell at us. He'd say, "Okay, come on, kids, get out of here. You know, here, I got to get a job for you." And he'd give us a job to do, or he'd give us $5 to go down on the street to get a model. You know, my brother and I were always, you know, into models. So he'd get us out of the house. But he had a sense of humor, too. He was always buying us little, you know, knickknacks from the magic stores, you know, little cameras that had birds that came out of the, you know. I think there was a side of Andy that was childlike. I think he actually communicated and had more fun with us than his brother or his sister-in-law. I think he liked us kids around a lot, I think.
Union Square was a terrible neighborhood. You could not walk through the park. There were heroin addicts everywhere, homeless people. So I went to Union Square. I went up to the sixth, took the elevator to the sixth floor, and you got off, and there was a little tiny, like, foyer, and made out of sheetrock, you know, and then there was a steel bulletproof door with a window that big that you looked into, and you said, there's a little sign that said, "Please ring bell," and I rang the bell, and through the door I could see Andy Warhol sitting at the reception desk, which was a Art Deco desk from France, actually, and next to him was this big Dalmatian, this black and white spotted dog, but it was stuffed. Their idea, I later learned, was that they thought crazy people would see the dog and think it was alive and get be too afraid to come in. Anyway, I rang the bell. Andy, there was a little buzzer under the desk. He buzzed me in. And I said, "Oh, hi, I'm Bob Colicello. You called me about my film reviews." And he said, "Oh, yeah, oh, God, it's so great to meet you. Gee, oh, I loved the review." And he was eating these vegetable purees from Brownie's health food store, which was around the corner, and one was like spinach puree and one was carrot puree, and he said to me, "Oh, would you like some puree?" And I was like,
Andy Warhol is like offering to share his lunch with me. You know, I mean, I remember also he was opening the mail, and he would take each letter and he would look at it like, look, like he was examining the quality of the paper, I don't know what. And then he would open it, and he would put like the bills here and the checks there, and the junk mail he would put in a box, and he would say, he would tear off each stamp off the envelope, the canceled stamp, and that was like his stamp collection. I didn't quite understand what he was doing, but later I figured this out.
Like all artists, he went through a bad slump, mid-career crisis in the 70s, and you know, you couldn't give away a Warhol. I mean, you could do commissions, portraits, but it was very risky and daring for him at that time to make art and have it be controversial, because it was not selling. Nobody wanted it. The critics were down on him. He was over. He was passé. And he handed me a human skull, and he said, Ronnie, I'd like you to photograph this for me. I'm thinking of doing some paintings. And they thought it was morbid or depressing, but I always saw it as the ultimate portrait. In other words, it's the portrait of every human being on the earth, because everybody has a skull.
For like 45 minutes, the ambulance didn't come, and he never passed out. And, I mean, to be in that kind of pain and not to pass out is extraordinary. And the fact that after the operation, he woke up about 10 minutes later. And those were the things they say that were the only signs that they were like the good signs and the things that sort of made, I mean, that's sort of why he lived, was because, I mean, he was so strong.
The shooting, I believe, was in 68. She came up on the elevator. I was in the dark room at the time, developing prints, you know, and I heard this very loud bang sound, unusual sound. And I knew it was an extraordinary sound that I should go see what it was, but because I had prints in the chemistry, I knew that Fred was up front and that Paul was up front, and I said, well, whatever it is, Fred and Paul are up there and they'll take care of it, and as soon as I finish these prints, I'll see what's going on, you know. So I finished up the prints I had in the tray, and I went out, and there was a divider from the screening room, my dark room way in the back, then the screening room, and then the reception office and workspace way up front. And when I went to the dividing wall, I saw Andy on the floor lying in a pool of blood. And I went over to him and picked his head and shoulders up in my arms. And they told me that Valerie Solanas had shot him. So I didn't see the actual shooting. As I said, I was in the dark room. But I did get to be with Andy right after the shooting. And when I was holding him, you know, I was crying, and he said, oh, Billy, don't make me laugh, it hurts too much. And, you know, so he was like delirious, you might say.
Really, I mean, he was something else. I mean, he was very strong, very, very strong. John and I were talking about how mentally strong he was. Like, John had felt after the shooting that, you know, he'd been physically hurt, but mentally he was still very, very tough minded guy. And everybody had said to him, hey, Andy, maybe we should get a lock on the door or something, you know, like, or at least have somebody look at who comes in here first. But that was just part of it, and he paid a terrible price for that.
Yeah, a lot of people didn't know Andy Warhol's name was Andrew Warhola.
He had immigrant parents that came right from Eastern Europe. They came from a little village called Mikola in Eastern Slovakia. And they were, it was a Carpathian village, and they spoke their own dialect. And they had, his parents had a huge influence on why he became who he became.
Here's a group of people where the spirituality is very important, is the spiritual dimension of my uncle's life. Honestly, I got this vivid image. Before he would leave the house, this is up on 89th and Lexington when we moved from 34th Street, he never left the house without saying, Ma, Ma, I'm leaving. And you should be doing something, and she'd come over. And they would stand on the stairway, he'd have his little prayer book with the Slavonic on one side, English. He said all his prayers in Slavonic. And he'd begin, oh, Jesus, and I'm the best seed, and my grandmother back and forth, and they would pray. And she'd bless him, and he'd be on his way. That was important. That spiritual dimension, this goes back to growing up in Oakland, Rusko Dolina, the iconostas, the icons. Whether my uncle was fully aware of the influence, it was there.
I don't know anything about Andy Warhol. I don't know a thing of what he is about, because he lets you pour it all out to him, and it's, oh really, oh really.
It's fun to talk to Andy because it's sort of like talking to nothing, because you just keep talking and he never says anything. So you go on, and you keep talking, and he just goes, And you keep bringing up new subjects, and he'll just go, So that makes it more fun because it's almost like talking to yourself.
Let's say you become like a sister. That's what it is. Andy's like a sister when you become very close. Someone who you can call up on the phone and gossip with and not feel bad about gossiping. That's how I feel about Andy.
Bruce Bernard, who was a wonderful picture editor, he called me up and he said, Red, he said, you free this afternoon? I think it was already about 3 o'clock. And I said, well, yeah, I am. He said, well, can you get down to the Ritz Hotel and photograph Andy Warhol? Do I want to photograph Andy Warhol? Get out of here. You know what I mean? Wonderful job. This guy comes up and he goes, hi, I'm Ryan Silowitz. He's the editor of Interview magazine, Andy's magazine. He says, Andy's busy now. He said, can you wait? We'll be right with you. And I said, everyone's very polite. I said, okay, sure, we'll wait. So we wait. And finally, he says, Andy's coming. And Andy comes in. Andy's like really little guy. He's really small. And he's got his funny silver wig on. And he's dressed English fogey. Waistcoat, all the stuff. And he goes across and he sits down in this little sofa, and which makes him even smaller. And I go across to him and I go, hi, Andy, really nice to meet you. And he shakes hand, and it's the classic wet, dead fish hand. He looks up at me and he goes, do you know what, see? I said, I'm sorry. And then he went, you've got two different coloured socks on. And I said, oh, yeah, so I have. That's great, I like that. And he said, what do you want to do? And I said, and he turned out to be one of the best sitters I've ever had. He knew exactly what lens I was using. Is that the 24 or the 28? I do like the 24 on the Nikon. It's a 28mm on this one. And he set it all up, and off we went. And he was absolutely, did whatever I asked him to do. He was the perfect sitter. And bang, 7 o'clock, we were gone.